Right, so we just posted this on YouTube Live and on Google Plus. It's also up on stuckincustoms.com. So this is the pre-show. We have about 5 minutes of this, and then we'll go right into the real show. It got dark where you are, Dallas. What happened?
We're a studio now.
Yeah.
Ah, okay. There's nothing strange behind you, is there?
No, nothing at all.
You guys look like you're in a tent. It's like a camp out.
You won't be revealing anything unusual to us behind you during the show, will you?
Certainly not.
We're nowhere. We just live in this space of
We edit in a cave.
It does. It looks like you're in a tent because you're leaning forward a little bit.
Yeah.
Posture. There we go.
We're not hiding anything at all.
Not awkward? No.
No, not awkward at all.
I'm going to have to drop out then. Because it causes an echo when I try the player.
So what happened, Keith? Give us your technical difficulties.
Well, it's not a technical difficulty. I'm broadcasting your live player. And so I'm doing it on the same computer. I'm a member of the Hangout in, which I can't do, because if I do that, the audio from the player echoes. I don't know. Did you hear an echo? Maybe it was just me hearing it.
I'm trying to load it up, but it's just
Well, I'm not broadcasting right now.
I don't want you to drop out. I'd like to have you in.
Basically, what he's doing is he's streaming your on-air version, Trey, not the in-hangout version.
Ah, okay. So
that's what I was trying, because if I do that, this was something that David and I wanted to try, because if I did that, then it's pre-formatted, because the format of the player is different than the it's symmetrical and it's fixed, and and it automatically switches based on what you do. But if I can't, so Dave, do you want me to try that, or do you want me to stay in the Hangout and broadcast the Hangout as best as I can generically?
I don't know.
It's your
test.
It's
up to you.
Am I supposed to know what any of this means?
No. Well, Trey wants you to stay in, right?
So, all right.
Stand on top for technical difficulties.
Okay, then give me a minute. Oh, shoot, you're at 10 o'clock.
Hey, Todd, this is kind of unfair to you because we're all speaking English right now, so you probably can't figure out a lot of this.
All right, so
sorry.
I'm going to broadcast.
I didn't get
I'm
going to
broadcast the in. Hang on, just give me a minute to set it up. But I'm not going to do it formatted.
Yeah, Todd only knows the King's English.
Yeah. Oh, I really, because I was going to do a series of clicks and popping sounds. I thought isn't that the local indigenous language? Like,
no, they all say yes.
Oh, just a lot of vowel shortening and grunting, really, actually, but,
bollocks.
Yeah, that sounds like the whole 27 years of my marriage.
Hey, let's not go there.
Hey, Todd, I love, I'm getting into all the local news here in New Zealand. I did not like the local news in the States. It was always, down or whatever. But here, it's there were two big stories. One of them was about people stealing jackets off of horses. That was the big story down here. And the other big story was that they did this linguistics analysis of people on TV in New Zealand, and they've decided that people are now talking more like Kiwis and less like the British people. I guess in the olden days, they felt like in order to be on TV, you had to speak as close to the Queen's English as possible. And now Kiwis are feeling more comfortable with themselves, and they're getting back into their more guttural roots, I guess.
Absolutely, old chap. Yes, yes.
Old chap. Love it.
And that didn't make CNN here?
No, I know. Yeah. No, it used to be terrible. You look at the old newscasts, and they have some guy who was a New Zealander, but he'd just been locked in a cupboard at a private boarding school for 15 years or something and made to speak like the Queen, and it was just shocking.
Why would he speak? Everything shuts down.
All right, well, the countdown is down to zero, which means the show is starting. Welcome, everybody, to Trace Variety Hour number 45. I'm coming to you live from Queenstown, New Zealand. I have just moved in. This isn't my permanent room, though, because it's going to be over. There's a little, we've got a little guest cottage. Actually, it's a cabin. Looks like Jacob's cabin. And that's where I'm going to be most of the time once I get everything set up. But right now, this is the only 90-degree view cone in the house. It's not piled up with boxes, and everything's in disarray. And you know what it's like when you move. Well, I'll get back to unpacking boxes right after this. But tonight's show is going to be great. We've got people from all over the world joining us, all kinds of cool and fun photographers. We're going to share a lot of photos and catch up and talk about techniques and what's going on, and it'll be great fun tonight. So let's start with a round of introductions. How about you? Let's start on the far left with this very unusual tent-like situation. Dallas, what's happening over there?
Oh, you want to know the story behind our tent?
Yeah. Well, yes. Like you, we also only have a 90-degree viewing cone that is not filled with boxes. You know, we can totally relate. We just moved, just over 2 weeks ago. So, and I guess now we have to do a big reveal, right? Yeah. So here's
what we did. We set this up just for everybody to see our new view.
Ta-da. Whoa.
Amazing.
Wait a minute.
How's that?
clever.
Della, stand up and show us what we're seeing here. Point around and let us know what's going on.
Well, we just moved to Kailua on the island of Oahu in Hawaii, and the view is pretty fantastic. Let's see if I can do this.
Wow. So those are our neighbors.
Yeah. But yeah, we got those mountains.
So if you guys look over that way, that pass over there is where the H3 on Oahu comes into Kailua. And then if you guys look all the way over that way, there's another cut. And that's where the Pali Highway is, which is a very, very, very old road. Carries a lot of story here in Hawaii. And then, like, all the mountain.
And then this is actually a marsh in front of our apartment building. So
lots
of native wetland birds and stuff. So, yeah.
Oh, wow. That's great.
That's our new digs.
That's very cool. And, Dallas, we'll talk more about this later, but I was just flipping through my flipboard, and I saw one of your photos featured in a prominent magazine article, so that's very... We'll get to that later. I won't steal your stuff.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, Trey, if you can get to that later, because it's not enough that they're young and good-looking and living in Hawaii. If you could give us more reasons to hate them, I would appreciate it.
Speaking of which, Trey, I was watching the Descendants last weekend, and it was all filmed in Hawaii, and I was sitting there going, what the hell did Trey move to New Zealand for? You know, why on earth did he not?
Well, I don't know. I saw emails that you sent me in hexameter pentameter, and it was just, you know, touching.
I don't know.
Gordon.
Dallas almost decided to become a Kiwi yourself.
Yeah, if I hadn't met this guy, I probably would have moved to New Zealand, too. So.
This is because of me, isn't it, guys?
Yeah.
Actually, Hawaiian Airlines just announced that they're going to start flying direct to New Zealand, so I might have to go bother some people in person.
So if you guys happen to have spare couches.
We do. I've got a couch right here.
All right.
Whoa, look at that.
There's nobody on it right now.
Sleeping at all.
All right. Hey, Gino, tell us all about you and your situation.
Well, I don't know. You kind of freaked me out. The situation. Is there something that you need to tell me about?
No, I just thought, you know.
Well, yes, I am dating the guy from Jersey Shore, Mike the Situation. I don't know if everybody thinks that or not. But besides that, everything's fine. I'm doing well. Austin in general is kind of still in the wake. It's like when a tsunami comes into your town and then it leaves, and yeah, the tsunami's technically over, but the damage is still there. That's the way Austin is now that Trey's gone. Shock, people throwing themselves in front of metro buses. It's pretty bad. Occupy Austin stopped altogether. Nobody even cares anymore. So.
It's funny you should say that, but all those things happened in New Zealand when Trey arrived. So.
Yeah. Well, he drags a lot of that in with him. He's got his own little sphere of influence. You know.
A sphere of misery. Oh, well.
Yes. Yeah. So he's like the stock market. You know, one day you're happy, the next day you're broke. You know, you don't know what to do. But, no, I'm doing well. I just got back. We took a trip. It was about 4,500 miles. We went from Austin up into the Badlands of South Dakota, and then we went over to Yellowstone and Devil's Tower and the Grand Tetons, and then we went down through Utah and did the whole, you know, Arches National Park and Canyonlands and all of that, and then down through New Mexico and then back to Texas. That took us a couple of weeks, and so... the pictures we're going to show later, or I'm going to show later through Dave, are all from that trip, and that was really, that was like a life-affirming. You know, you get busy in life and work and the grind, and you just get kind of caught up, and then you take a trip like that, and you just get reconnected with Mother Earth, and it really helps you realize, you know, kind of helps you perspectivize things. And also, you learn how to say words in new ways, like perspectivize. So that's it for me.
We'll see your photos later, Gino. Thank you very much. And so, hey, Dave, I skipped you. Sorry about that. Hey, Dave, what's up?
Hey, everybody. I'm Dave. You can find me at plusdave.com if you're bored one day, you know, see some photos and stuff.
That's quite the sales pitch. I like it.
Come for an exciting time.
Soft sell.
Yeah, I wasn't sure whether I was supposed to go to your site to get more bored or less bored, Dave.
More bored. Yeah.
I like that his site is called Plus Dave. I should start calling mine like Fat Gino. You know.
And then in the middle square, almost-ish, we have Keith. Hey, Keith, what's up?
Hi, Trey. Thanks for having me. I'm Keith Barrett. You can find me just by Googling my name. I dare you. And on vidcastnetwork.com, live streaming hangouts and other things. And I'm just a budding amateur photographer.
Okay, cool. And hello, Mel. How are you?
Hey, I'm good. I'm so glad. No offense, Keith or Dave, but I'm so glad you guys went after Gino and Dallas, because I'm sitting here like looking at my closet door thinking, how the hell are you going to like, be with that? So, thanks, guys.
We're the Gino buffer.
Yeah, I know. And then Gino, who's got this amazing trip story, and here's me in my closet. And then this cute puppy jumps up on Dallas. I'm like, anyway, I'm Mel, Mel Peifer. You can find me on Google+, of course. Let's see, what am I doing? I am working, okay, Tom Gort, another photographer on Google+, is working with me patiently to plan a Minneapolis photo walk, the first one, first Google+ Minneapolis photo walk ever. So that's coming out August 11th. God, August 11th, yeah. Other than that, you know, that's about all. I teach
now,
art.
Now, Mel, are you guys going to purify your souls in the waters of Lake Minnetonka during that photo walk?
No, we're going to head out. We're going to go downtown. We're gonna start at the Mary Tyler Moore statue.
Wow.
I'm all excited, yeah. I'm all excited. And Tom, he's, oh my God, bless his soul, he's dealing with me. I'm like, yeah, Tom, let's do this. I'm so excited. I haven't done a thing. He's done everything. I feel so bad. But he's a lawyer. I think his brain works like that. I'm just an artist. I'd do it the night before if I could. So, yeah, that's what I have going on.
Cool. Thanks, Mel. Thanks, and
then
we have Nick. Hey, Nick, what's going on?
Hey, I'm Nick Gatens. You can find me on Google+ or search for my name on Google, and I happen to be the only Nick Gatens on the Internet, so probably find me just about anywhere, but I also have a website, nickgatens.com, very surprising. And, I live in Louisville, Kentucky. I have clearly done some very interesting things, not quite like going to Hawaii. I did go across the river into Indiana one time. It's very exciting. So, as you can see, also very, very small studio area here, which happens to be in the kitchen. So, tiny house, but that's all right. I'm a photographer and designer, graphic designer, and that was my original background, and that's what got me into photography to begin with. You know, you work with photos all day, and that kind of thing, and it's interesting to see it from that side and then come into actually doing the photography, I think you kind of have a different perspective on it when you get started. So that's kind of cool. And the other thing is the main thing I'm involved with here on G Plus is the Exposed G Plus Photography magazine, and that's me and Levi Moore and Jeff Yale, and we put that out once every 3 or 4 months. I think we're going to try to do 4 issues a year. And if you just search on Google Plus for that, it's Exposed, and you can download the first 2 issues. The second issue just came out about a week or two ago. So,
and that's really well done, by the way. I just checked that out the other day.
Thanks. We're just really trying to do something with the community, and everything that we do is tied through Google. So we host the magazine in Google Drive and share it from there, and we're able to link things. So if you download the PDF, if you click on a photo in the PDF, it opens up that image in Google Plus in your browser, so you can leave a comment or plus one right there. So
it's
really
so cool.
Try to integrate everything together and really share, you know, people that maybe don't get as much exposure otherwise. So
excellent. Thanks, Nick. Good to see you. And Todd, give us a scoop.
The scoop. You put me in the Gino position here. I'm Todd Sisson. I have I have a website, sisson.co.nz, another eponymous photography website. I do a variety of stuff from commercial, which is where I started out originally with shooting people, and then mainly these days I am a living doing landscape, which landscape work, and I live about an hour away from Queenstown, which is where Trey is based, and I think I really am in need of one of Gino's life-affirming trips, though. Actually, I'm about ready to book one. We've been sitting in the fog here for a couple of months now, and it's time to this Hawaii thing here, and the Paris Hilton dog as well. It's looking pretty good.
Now, Todd, when you say you're doing a lot of landscaping work now, are you talking about like gardening, or what do you mean?
I'm pretty sure that'll be more profitable, actually, Gino. I'm considering it, but landscape photos.
Oh, yeah. I've seen some of your work, so I thought you were maybe mowing lawns, but okay, that's fine.
Yeah, I'll show you a couple, Gino.
I'm just joking. I love you, Todd.
I don't have any sense of humor, Gino. I got you, didn't I? Excellent.
Hey, Todd, why don't you grab one of those postcards behind you that's awesome and show it to us.
Yeah, my background. I haven't done my view, have I? I can't move it because my computer's sort of chained to the desk with cables, but these are all postcards.
Are you broadcasting from a B. Dalton's bookstore, or where are you?
From the stock room. These boxes full of postcards like this. Where are we? Yeah. Like that.
Are those yours? Oh my God!
I don't have my earphones on. Sorry.
I knew that this guy was self-absorbed, but now I know. Look at this. Nothing but Todd Sisson material. Hundreds and thousands of them.
And I don't even sell that stuff. It's just for my own personal edification. That's what I know.
I was like, he doesn't sell those. He literally just ordered those so he could look at them over and over.
Yeah, I can say I'm widely published. It's the best of both worlds.
Yeah.
Every once in a while, he spreads them around on his bed and
you know what you could do with those postcards is like use them like a flip book that never changes. It's just a constant toxic.
I tell you, digital is so overrated. It's just that much more efficient to get this stuff printed and have it in your garage. It's fantastic.
Or your garage.
Yeah. That too. Yeah.
Hey, all right.
Go ahead,
Todd.
No, it's all that timing, Trey. I missed my moment. You blew it for me, mate.
All right, no worries. Well, so before we get started around here, I wanted to thank our sponsors and talk about this new upcoming tutorial that starts less than a week. You only have 1 week left to register for this new art of photography class I'm giving. It's all online. It's all on video. And we've got great sponsors. They are Photomatics, HDR Soft, Smug Mug, Nick Software, and Adorama. We have all kinds of prizes, cameras, all kinds of amazing stuff. So come sign up. We'll have a great time. And the biggest question that we've been getting lately is, if you miss the live part, can you download later? And yes, you know, if you're registered, that's no problem. All that stuff is available to you. And Dave's going to be helping me out with that. And we have a little rehearsal later this week to make sure everything's going to be perfect. Sure it will be. And then we'll get ready to go just less than a week from now. So I'm super excited, and I know we already have a ton of people coming. It's going to be great, great fun. So anyway, thanks to the sponsors for that. All right, so everyone brought photos and little stories and all kinds of things. Actually, I thought I would start by telling you guys something that I observed, and I wondered if you guys have seen anything like this yourself. So, you know, I'm always posting on Google Plus photos and little stories and this and that. And I put up a photo, I guess, 3 days ago. I was up on a mountain here, and I took a photo, you know, of the scene down below, the landscape scene, and I used my Android to take a photo of the camera on the tripod that was taking the photo, right? And I've always said, I'm sure some of you guys have heard me say this before, that your main audience as a photographer should not be other photographers, right? It should just be the general public that doesn't really know anything about photography. And this has always been kind of my goal, and probably where most of the fans and stuff come from. But one thing that I noticed, and I should have, anyway, this really struck me, is that so I put up this photo of a camera taking a photo, and there were so many comments in the thread on Google Plus and Facebook and everywhere else, and it said, oh my God, what a unique idea to take a photo of a camera taking a photo. And lots of people said, I bet this is the first time that this has ever been done. You know, what an incredible idea. You know, and it just reminds me that, you know, well, this is something that photographers do all the time with other photographers. It's like the oldest, it's not even a trick, it's just something you do, you know. But the general public has never even conceived of this kind of idea before. They found it, you know, just wonderful that anyone would come up with such a wild idea.
I can see what's going to be.
Deception of photography.
Yeah.
Well, that's interesting, Trey, that you talk about having your audience, your main audience, you don't want them to be photographers. And obviously, other photographers, generally speaking, are not going to be blown away to the extent that they're going to buy anything from you. So, right off the bat. Although I know in your case, Trey, that you actually do sell to other photographers. But, you know, your average people like myself aren't going to have other photographers buying your work. But also, another good reason why that is so is because non-photographers don't know anything about photography, so they don't notice the little flaws. And I've noticed that other photographers will come look at my work, and they'll point out, oh, look, you've got a little burnt green thing going around the edge, or, oh, you dodged and burned this. And they look at that as a negative, whereas the general public says, oh, that's amazing how the edges are burnt, and look, you've got this nice little green art edge. You know.
Yeah.
So they have no idea that that's not a good thing, or you're breaking a rule or something. And they just love the emotion or the feeling of the piece.
I think the next crazy thing he's going to do is take a picture of himself using a mirror.
Oh, yeah.
In a bathroom. I'll do some bathroom selfies.
Yeah.
Don't forget the duck face.
And the effect of toothpaste.
Yeah, dirty mirrors.
Wait a minute. Wait, there's... Mel, do you ever take pictures of yourself in the bathroom?
Not on purpose.
I think it is a yes.
You know, no, I, honest to God, I did for the very first time the other night. And it was because...
I knew it.
Well...
Why do all girls do this? No guys.
I've never had, though. No, but Lotus, it was because of Lotus Carroll. Otherwise, I honest to God, if it wasn't for that woman, I never would have thought about it. But I walked into this bathroom, and it wasn't the me I wanted to take a picture of. It was the mirror itself. The thing was all graffitied. It was amazing. And then I just happened to be in the picture because it was a mirror. And then I thought, well, Lotus can do it. I can do it. And I did it for the first time ever. It was. It's not going to happen again unless I find another graffiti here.
That's what they always say.
I know, and it starts the addiction. Well, yeah, that toothpaste, that looks like graffiti.
It was
the gateway. No, every bathroom has to somehow top that bathroom. And if that happens, then yes, you may see another picture of me in the bathroom. Maybe.
Geez, I've done it, so why shouldn't you, you know?
I figured everyone else is doing it, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Funny story, we're actually beaten out by a bathroom mirror shot in like this... in a contest one time for American Eagle. We were just like, oh, we'll just submit pictures. So like we had these beautiful like pictures of like a girl using an American flag and being all American, and then phone shot. And
yeah, phone shot of a bathroom mirror picture, and we're like, and they won first place, and we're like, oh.
Does that make you mad?
Yes.
What?
No, we
That's
hate
your MySpace profile picture.
Yeah, and you know, it was just like
it was a popularity contest, so it had
a bigger following. So it wasn't a commentary on the photography. It was just like, God. So that's my story about a mirror shot.
Yeah. Which I do all the time.
Hey, Dallas, do you guys join lots of contests?
I never did for a long time. We did the American Eagle one last year for fun, and that resulted in us actually getting a few of our images on their billboard in Times Square, which is pretty cool. But
on the whole, not really.
Not that often. I've just started recently entering some stuff because I figured, you know, hey, why not? Try it out. So
the stuff that's judged by editors instead of how many votes you can get, because we hate spamming like our
vote for me. We don't like to do that. So.
But you know, when there's somebody like, you know, the National Geographic people, you know, being like, oh, we're going to have our editors look at your photos. It's like we're okay with that.
Yeah, so tell us about this National Geographic thing.
Oh, okay. So actually, the picture, the Lava Kiss, as it's kind of been called,
dubbed.
Yeah, I entered it in the National Geographic Traveler Photo Contest on a whim. I was just like, you know, I have this. Might as well. It's probably the best picture I'll ever take in my life. So I submitted it, and then, you know, I kind of actually forgot that I had entered the contest. And then we were out doing a sunrise fashion shoot on the beach a few days ago, Wednesday? And someone messages us on Google Plus, and they're like, hey, your picture's in focus. And we're like,
No way,
because I'm a huge fan of Alan Taylor and In Focus and all those blog posts. I just drool over all of them all the time. But then we went on, and it wasn't just in the blog post. It was the first image above the cut. So I was super stoked on that, like geeking out
that's
so
awesome.
Hard.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Big Alan Taylor fan girl.
Yeah.
big. He's on Google Plus, by the way.
Yes.
So I'm going to show this. I was using Flipboard.
Oh, that's one.
Apps. And, so this was in The Atlantic, right, which I guess was talking about the various photos chosen by National Geographic.
Yeah.
And I saw your photo on there. I was so shocked.
Yes, we were too.
Yeah.
No, like, yeah, people started messaging us. They're like, oh, my God. And we're like, what happened?
Yeah.
So completely caught us off guard. But, and then it just went everywhere from there.
What happens if you did you win, or are you a finalist, or what's the situation?
I don't know. I never came up for a popular vote for the viewer's choice, because the editors would pick their favorites for 14 weeks, and then you could vote on their favorites, and mine never came up there. And they haven't announced the actual winners yet. So
that means one of two things. Either we won, or they hated it.
So we'll
see. These viewers' choice contests are just the bane of the internet. They're stupid. It's so transparent what they're trying to do, and you know they're trying to like get people to socially talk. And it's especially bad for me because everybody sends me their stuff. Says Trey, will you please mention this so I can win this contest? So I always say no.
Oh, keep that in mind.
I feel really bad. Because I'm constantly saying no to people, so it's
no.
But for the main contest, it is a panel of judges, so we'll see what happens with that.
We don't go into popular vote stuff anymore. Just editor stuff, just because we don't want to be like
Vote for me, vote
like
for me.
Like spamming all our social media feeds with like asking people to vote for us. So.
Yeah.
I stopped doing the popular vote thing too because nobody would vote for me. So
yes, there's a lot of idiots out there, aren't there, Jan?
Yeah, I voted for me a lot, though. I was surprised I didn't
win. I'd vote for you.
Thanks.
Trey, you should put that photo of a photo or a photo of a camera up. It could be a real popular choice. Could be a winner, mate.
You know what he should do is get a mirror in a bathroom showing that photo.
Exactly.
Oh, my God.
Show that photo
on the iPad in a mirror on the webcam.
Yeah, and then do a screen snapshot of that while it's in a Hangout.
Yeah. People wouldn't even know what to think. They'd be speechless.
Be so avant-garde.
Nothing but net.
So, Todd, what have you been up to lately? Why don't you share some of your good stuff?
How do you go from them to me? I had six people between me and them. This is not good. I'm not ready for this, Trey. I'm gonna take over Dave's position. I want to hear from Gino. I've never met the guy, and he's looking pretty verbose. So. Well, you're serious, aren't you? You want me to go?
Okay, no, the thing is that Gino is just always gold, and, you know, I could just go to that guy anytime for something witty or redonkulous.
Saving him to last. Okay, I'll do some screen sharing. I'm going to actually depart a little bit from my usual photos of Todd and, you know, the usual thing. What do we got here? Hold on. Now, you've really thrown me here.
So, by the way, in any case, while you're doing that, Todd, I'll tell people something about you, which I hope is somewhat accurate. That Todd has, like, dominated the New Zealand postcard market. Like, you go into almost any place that sells postcards, and chances are you'll have some of Todd's work there in New Zealand. It's really quite an amazing accomplishment. It's I know nothing about that industry. It's not one that I'm into at all. So I was just really impressed that he's been able to accomplish so much at what is obviously a tender young age.
Well, can I say two things about Todd? And I mean this sincerely. One is that Todd is such a funny guy that I think it's easy for people to not realize how gifted he is as a photographer. But if you go look at this guy's work, I mean, he's got just incredible body of work. And I think it's only because he's so funny that it's easy to dismiss him as an artist.
I'm so glad the screen cheers up because I'm crying right now, Gino. I am.
And the second thing I wanted to say was how disingenuous for you to get invited to an on-air hangout and then say, oh, he wants to talk to me. I don't know what to do. I'm thrown for a loop. Come on. Get professional. Pull your notes out, man.
You're everything I hoped you'd be, Gino, and more. Trey, on that note, I watched about a 3.5-hour bloody mega hangout that you and seven other superstars were in about how to sell your photography, which just watched it yesterday, actually. It was, I put the link up on my G+ stream to it. It was actually a very interesting little topic, wasn't it? How did you feel about that?
I liked it. I don't even remember what I said anymore, but I hope it was useful or interesting or somewhat.
I won't repeat the there's one bit I won't repeat. Not on air here. People can go look at it. It's very humorous.
Okay. Trace,
Anyway, this is going circle here around the postcard thing because actually, you know, it's something I was very proud of. I am very proud of what we did, what Sarah and I achieved there, because it's not just me, it is my wife, Sarah, and I doing it. Unfortunately, we became very successful in a nascent industry, an industry that's on the decline, and it's now we've had a very good income coming in from something. It's not what it was, so it's a matter of, for a number of factors, so it's just a matter of I'm now in search of that next thing and we're at that new direction, really. So, it's a pity to see, but it's just life. It's just the reality of the way people are spending their money these days. So, anyway. So do you want me to continue on?
Yes.
Yeah. Continue. Okay. All right. I'm going to get rid of the screen share here for a moment.
Yeah, because that thing's boring.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Actually, I'm not gonna just sit there and share photos because I've been on a couple of these hangouts, and if anybody has seen me before, I've shown all my best shots. I've got none left, so it's only 10 of them. I'm not really what you'd consider to be a technical photographer. It's never really interested me, all this the technology and all the behind, and cameras have never been really a big obsession for me. But I have become really quite interested in the results I've been getting out of my new Nikon D800, because it's sort of like I was really quite I've been a big user of ND filters, which for those of you in watching, I know you guys know what they are, but for those of you who don't know what they are, they're these graduated neutral density filters, which I've sort of used. They've been the backbone of most of my best photos over the years. And so shots like this one here of Key Summit, that's been made with an ND filter. Pretty much all these great sort of sunset situations, I've used this real analog system, and it's sort of the dream, I guess, when I moved to digital, is that I wouldn't have to use filters like this. And that's really because digital hasn't been able to do this. That's why HDR is one of the reasons HDR, we all sort of leapt into that early on, and with varied success. In my case, very little, obviously. I stuck with the analog approach. And all of a sudden, I'm still been persevering with these things, with ND filters, and this is one I just shot 3 or 4 months ago, and I just put it up on G+ yesterday, and it's another shot that's been made using one. And then, but they have their problems, and this is a good example. I'm going to go back in time here up to the beginning of the shot before I edited it. Just these things like over, you probably can't see it that well actually on the screen share, but there's a big scratch in my filter and it starts flaring and everything. It's completely garbage. So anyway, I did a bit of a test the other morning. Is this boring, you guys? Because I don't have to do it if you don't want to. But
no, just, I like it. I just like hearing you say garbage.
I should really be saying rubbish. It's the Americanization of New Zealand, so rubbish, yeah. I've been sort of wondering, because I've been getting these shots out of the 800, and I'm thinking, I don't really think I need to use a bloomin' ND filter for this stuff, because it actually seems to be, you know, a waste of time. And but I thought it might have been sort of the placebo effect. You know, you go drop $5,000 on a camera, you want to see something different out of it, don't you? You want to see some results. So anyway, I went and did a very highly unscientific experiment the other morning up the hill from us here. And I shot this sucker here with a three-stop grad on it. And I thought, well, what can I get if I shoot this without a grad? And it didn't come out looking like this, but this is the end result. I've ended up being able to take an image, and I'll do a before and after here, using that camera that's gone from this sort of dark, muddy, underexposed. This was a one-stop underexposed off the meter, off the recommended exposure. And I've ended up with this beautifully exposed thing with no flare, no rubbish. And then when you brighten it, there's just no problems in the shadow area. It's remarkable. So I also did that the other way, going from overexposed and pulled it back from the sky, and it's even better probably. So I'm sort of calling the ND filtered toast after the next iteration. I know Trey's pronounced the death of any more iterations or generations of DSLRs, but you know, when we do see some more come through, I think, you know, they're going to be a thing of the past. I'm probably not going to be using them that much in the future.
Are you saying that the raw file that comes out of the D800 is so robust that you can get anything you need to out of that raw file, and you don't need to carry around this big piece of glass anymore?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, I wouldn't say that it'll cover all. That's a reasonably that's not as extreme a exposure situation as you get. You could go deeper shadows, brighter brights than that situation, but that I couldn't have done that on any other camera I've ever owned, just out of one single exposure. Both sides of exposed, if you know what I mean. I've gone from overexposed and underexposed and brought it back, so the histogram is absolutely perfect. It's standard. It's absolutely blows your mind. And I've got a really good comparison here with whoops, what have I done? With my old Canon 5D Mark II. And now I'm going to switch to library mode. And we'll grab both of those. And
hey, Todd, do you use a... You're a Nikon guy like me, and you have a 14 to 24, I assume, yes?
No, I don't use that one, because I'm a polarizer freak. No, I love polarizers, and that's why I don't use that one. And I've
I've got that 14 to 24 lens on my D800 too. And have you guys noticed, I want to jump in and ask a question of both of you guys, that with a single RAW, have you experimented at all on using a single HDR? Single, just one raw. There's so much data out of the D800 shots that I'm getting that I found I've been able to do pretty interesting shots with just one, as opposed to multiple.
Yeah, I do. You know, I do that all the time.
Yeah. So this is to get an HDR effect, you mean? So as you get, I don't ever sort of go down that road of merging different exposures out of the single one, but for me, where I'm trying to, I sort of try to get an oldie school look out of these crazy lighting situations, and where you'd have to be exposure blending two images. I think, you know, I'm closer to that great day where I can pretty much pull it out, and even if I'm bracketing, I think I'll only go one stop either side of recommended, and that would be enough in most circumstances, I think, to give you a huge amount of latitude. This extremely exciting shot I've got here just shows the left-hand side. It's pretty fascinating. The D800 is just a magnificent camera. You can just take such great photos with it. I've sort of been going down this hideous. I don't know. I realized I got this really hideously nerdy side to me, and I've taken these really bad photos. I'm going to be photographing public toilets before I know it, looking for distortion in brick walls. But on the left, I don't know, I'm going to let this settle down, on the render is the Canon 5D in identical exposure conditions. They're both picked out of the meters, both metered exactly the same for the circumstances. And I've underexposed one stop to pull it up and see what we get. I don't know whether you can see it, but the Canon on the left is just falls to bits in these dark areas on the fence paling there. It's just got this hideous crisscross color noise. I'll put these up on my blog. I'm spamming the internet with all these really bad comparisons at the moment. Actually, I'll give you the details to my blog in a minute. But the Nikon's just clean. It's just absolutely clean, and it's been pulled up about two stops there. I'll show you very quickly before I finish. That's a before and after. So that's how dark it's come from. That's how underexposed it is in that area. This here's the Canon we're looking at. You can see it just falls to bits in that in here with color noise. And then I'm going to click on this over here. Get that load. But anyway, what it's coming down to is a vastly different style of shooting for me. And I think I'm sort of at the point, there we go, finally. So I don't know whether you can see that or not. We've gone from blackest black on that fence paling to bring out full detail without any noticeable noise at 100%. It's quite remarkable. So, and finally, here's one. Actually, we'll get rid of that. Just go back to that. I put on my blog the other day that I think it's sort of turning me into like 1973 Elvis. I'm like going to become the equivalent as a photographer. A shot like this, which is, it's a hideous shot, but I basically walked out of my, hold on, sorry, look at that, that's just terrible. to get this shot here, I walked out of my in-law's living room, put down my beer, walked out, handheld a shot at ISO 400, and you go from this hideous hunk of junk on the left-hand side here to something that's just got the full everything. You know, it's just like, it's crazy. I think you can be so lazy with the setup using VR and you don't even need a tripod. It's quite scary. It's very sloppy, but, you know, anyway, these are my findings. I just thought you may be interested in getting my thoughts on that.
I can't speak for everybody, Todd, but I think I could definitely speak for almost everybody. You have cured me of insomnia. So
Thank you, Gino. It's good to know there was some benefit there. So that's me. I'm out of here.
Oh. So, actually, I found the exact same thing with the D800. It allows me to be lazy and still later come back and post process something that didn't look like anything in camera to something that was very interesting later. So I get what you were saying through all of those words you used.
Yeah, there was a lot of rubbish there, and garbage too.
I can't remember who it was, but this was like a couple of months ago. I saw somebody who had, they were doing some studio stuff, and they shot several, sessions with their flash set up and everything, and they had a few photos where the flash didn't fire. So if you just look at the image itself, it's just black. It's solid black. It doesn't look like anything. And what he was able to pull out of that from doing the same thing that you're doing looked better than the ones he had when the flash fired. And it just blew my mind at the time, because it's if you just looked at it and didn't know to mess with it or didn't even think to mess with it, you would have just thrown it in the garbage.
Yeah. Actually, most mistakes look better than my flash photography as well, so it's not, probably not uncommon. It's it's a real groundbreaker. I mean, what are you finding, Trey? I mean, you're shooting this thing. Are you finding you're having to bracket less, or you changed your shooting in any way?
Well, I bracket anyway, because not just because I'm used to it. I'm very quick to reinvent the way I do things. But I figure as long as I'm there, the memory space is cheap. I only have to wait another couple seconds, and just in case, I go ahead and I grab it. And sometimes there is something moving, maybe there's the branches are moving or the cloud is moving, and then I have a few different choices where I can, maybe I like one configuration slightly more than another. And anyway, actually, I still think this is more the direction that we're going, is that you don't just get one raw file, but I think that you're going to get a bunch of raw files over a short first, and then you'll choose what, you could pluck out the moment later.
That's what the next 7 does, right?
Yeah, the next 7, yes, but it's pretty scary. And especially noticed that for my kids, because if they're running around, and they're making little expressions and this and that, it's better to have more choices than less, really. Because then it's actually kind of fun. The thing is, you have to. I do realize this, and I know there's a lot of people that don't like it. You've got to really enjoy scrubbing through your photos in Lightroom and picking out the winners. I mean, this is a process you have to actually love. You don't wash the dishes to get them done. You wash the dishes to wash the dishes. Right. And that's kind of the way I feel about post-processing and hanging out in Lightroom.
Yeah, I'm finding that, for me, it's like there's two different disciplines and there's two different experiences with your photography. And, I'll go off and shoot the kids, and I like nothing better than putting on a really fast lens and just shooting stuff. And then I'm finding I hardly have to, out of the D800 again, hardly, because the tone is so good, having to do anything to them. And I love those sort of photos, but then there's the other end of the spectrum where you're just getting something, you've got this latitude to play and go completely spastic, which I do regularly, and explore, and you've got that option to do nothing or just go bananas, and it's pretty cool. But, that's quite a distinct thing from photography, if you know what I mean, from being out in the field and being a purist and grabbing the ultimate shots, right there and then, and never having to touch it,
Hey, Trey, real quick, it was, why do you wash? You wash the dishes.
I wasn't sure I agreed with that one either.
I wanted to write it down.
You gotta rinse and repeat, I think, is the thing.
Oh, okay. All right. The towel of Trey.
Yeah, that's the towel. It's a very zen thing, All right. Actually, it's actually pretty true if you think about a lot of different ways. If you kind of think about what you're doing as you're doing it. It's kind of more living instead of just thinking, oh, I got to get through this one thing before I can do the thing I really want to do.
I really want to get through this hangout.
I do know what you mean, though, that I find that now that the more proficient I get with Lightroom, the more when I'm out shooting, I think, wow, I think I really got something right there. I can't wait to get home to scroll through them and just see, like, what did I really get? I mean, it's like, you know, it's like you're wrapping up little presents that you're not going to get to open until you get home.
Yes, yes, you have crossed into the good side.
Now wait a minute. Now how did that go again, Gino? You're wrapping up little presents. I wanted to write down.
You're wrapping the presents so that you can wash them in the dishes, right?
Now, that was great. You said that.
I got out of it. You hired Trey Ratcliff to wash your dishes.
All right. Well, he likes it.
So, all right, Dallas, you just put up a post about the purity of photos or something, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, I shared an article. I didn't even leave a comment on it. I had just saw it really fast while we were setting up to do this, and I was like, oh, this is cool, so shared. Yeah, and it was basically about how with digital, a lot of people, if they're just getting into it, they don't understand that the camera processes a JPEG file, and then if you're shooting RAW, it's not necessarily going to look fantastic out of camera because, you know, it's got the whole range and it's not going to be that contrasty. And so it was basically talking about how that related to darkroom editing, dodging and burning, and mentioning Ansel Adams and everything, which I personally think is something that needs to be put out there a little bit more, especially because there's some people who will just be like, well, did you Photoshop that? And I'm like, well, I edited the color and contrast and tone in Lightroom. And they're like, so it didn't look like that out of camera. And I'm like, well, no, but is that a problem? You know, so stuff like that, I think people are used to maybe, I don't know, taking their film to the photo lab and getting prints back and they look great. So they're like, oh, it's good out of camera, when in fact, you know, the labs optimize your pictures and stuff like that.
Not only do the labs optimize your pictures, but the film itself has different properties where, you know, the film itself will render greens a certain way or render, you know,
skin tones
a certain way. And that's the thing, like, if you want to go by that philosophy, then, you know, Ansel Adams, one of America's great photographers, was just an absolutely terrible photographer because his negatives looked awful. You know, his magic really came out in the darkroom, where he used to, like, say, okay, I'm shooting in order to get as much data as humanly possible. I'm going to bring it out, and I know what I'm going to shoot, and I know what I'm going to bring out.
Yeah. I think there was a quote in the article that was Ansel Adams, and it was something like, if the negative is the sheet music, the print is the performance. And I was like, hey, that's pretty cool.
I wonder what the common man... that might sound bad the way I say that, but the average person that goes out, you know, with a good camera, maybe even a beginner DSLR or even a high-end consumer camera, you know, I think that, you know, you talk about maybe they're used to getting prints done. I bet there's an increasing percentage of the population that's just never gotten a print from a photo lab, and so that's not a basis for comparison. Mm-hmm. And then I've also heard some studies and seen some articles that there is a huge percentage of the population that has pretty nice cameras, but they never put the pictures on their computer. They just leave them on their camera, right? And then they pass their camera around, and they get memory cards. So I think there's this giant group of people out there that they haven't grokked this idea that you take the photos and then you put them on your computer, and then you do a little magic on them, and then you share those. That it's like there's a big missing piece of the puzzle for a huge part of the population, and that part, I guess, that step is pretty intimidating.
Well, I think that also a lot of people just don't know that step needs to be taken. I know when I was first starting out in photography, I was like, I got a DSLR, my pictures will look great now.
Yeah.
And, you know, I kept trying, and I'm like, why can't my pictures look like that? And I'm looking in magazines, and I'm like, what is wrong? And then one day I got an offer in the mail from Adobe saying, like, hey, buy Lightroom. And I was like, you know, it was a really big discount because they were about to upgrade. So I was like, okay, I'll try it out. And, you know, it literally all it took was a white balance adjustment and a contrast adjustment. All of a sudden, my stuff started looking, I'm not going to say like the stuff in magazines, but a lot more like it. And I was just like, this is what I was missing. So I think that a lot of people just don't know that is like that one last step that you need to take to really bring your photos to 100%.
Full potential.
I don't think people realize that. You know, they get the good camera and then they assume that their photos are going to just look like that right out of the camera. But then they are also, you know, the people who don't take it to that next level are probably the same ones who leave their photos on the, you know, on the memory card and just kind of, they don't really have the desire to take it the extra step, because I did the same thing that you did. I mean, I got my first DSLR, and I'm like, this is great. My photos are going to look amazing. And I put them on the computer, and I'm like, this is worse than my other camera. This is awful. You know, but it took me wanting to make it look more like what I wanted it to be. You know, you just really have to take that step.
I get the impression that a lot of people that's just not their goal. You know, like my mom got a point and shoot because she sees my photos and she wanted to be able to take her own photos, and she goes out in the yard and there's a deer that walks up and she takes a photo of it, and she's not like, she's satisfied with that because she took a photo of it, and that's it. Like, she doesn't care any further than that. She has this picture, she took it, and that's it, you know. And I think that's probably a big part of it too, at least in my experience. So,
which is fine. I got no problem with that, except when you're the son-in-law like me, who turns up to the in-laws and they go, "We've got all these photos from our South America trip, and they're on these 9 different cards. We don't know what to do with them." And you're like, "Oh," you're like, "Oh man, it's you know," and you end up having to try and sort it all out for them. It's unbelievable. I think there's just so much volume of stuff, and so much of it is people are taking so much meaning stuff that doesn't actually mean anything to them, because there's no cost to it per click. They end up not being able to deal with it. They're overloaded, so it's just a matter of putting it to one side and go and buy a new camera almost when that one fills up. I've seen it happen. Don't laugh.
I've just looked over at the comments. I like to watch the comments on Google+ and YouTube Live and on the blog. And people are blown away by your photos. People with names I can't pronounce, which means you're impressing people from all 7 seas.
Excellent. I'm the only one who's actually shown a photo yet, I think, so. Anyway. I'll take it.
Let's have Gino share, then. Let's see what Gino can bring to the table today.
Dave! Careful, Gino. You already earned yourself some snark on the other side.
I got snark? Oh, okay.
click on me. Click on me.
So this is one from Monument Valley. Dave's showing these, so thank you, Dave. I was in Monument Valley. Now, this is kind of interesting. You were talking about what you can pull out of a D800, because this shot was at night. I was down in the valley, and the sun had already gone down, and these horses just came rolling right in front of me. And I was absolutely blown away by how beautiful the setting was. And that's actually why I made this a black and white, because, you know, there just really wasn't enough light to get much out of the valley. So I just decided to make it more contrasty and stay with the black and white. But out of camera, when I got it into Lightroom, I was like, oh, no, there's nothing. But then after just playing around with it a little bit, there's so much data that you get out of the D800 that you have a pretty pleasing picture, nevertheless.
So. Sorry, go ahead.
No, he's got to be...
All I'm looking at is you at the moment, Gino, and it's not a pleasing picture.
Oh. Well... Now, you've been saving that one? Did you have that on one of your little cards?
It just came to me. I just spilled it.
You just wake up in the morning.
I can see a little wee thing down in the corner there from on Dave's stream, but I can't see your photo. It does look cool.
All right. Well, thanks. Sorry. All right, Dave, next. Let's see what else we got.
By the way, Todd, I'll give you a little primer in the Hangouts. If you click on that little square,
look at that. Oh.
Square.
Oh, that's just so satisfying. That is a nice photo. Oh, beautiful.
Oh, well, there you go. Unadulterated praise from down under. All right, so, Dave, let's scroll forward. Let's see what we got.
No, I was looking.
All right, now this one, we'll show this one real quick and just move on. But this is Johnny Depp. Way down in the bottom of that valley is Johnny Depp's filming The Lone Ranger down there. And so I'm not kidding. He was down there. They have a train, and they were filming down there. But this is Mesa Arch, and as many people know, in the Canyonlands. And I'll say, when you get there in the morning, there's a little window of time when the sun's coming up that it hits the bottom of this arch, and it literally turns orange. I didn't want to do a lot of photoshopping to this picture because I didn't want people saying, "Oh, that you just went in there and manipulated it, and you made it look like that." But that is actually what it looks like when you're there. That orange that's glowing on the bottom of that rock is so amazing. But I will tell you a little funny story about this. It's funny to me anyway. Todd, you can poo-poo it later in the garage. But when we were here, there was me, there was three Chinese people, and a Russian guy, a couple of Germans.
This sounds like a joke setup.
Yeah. No, I'm dead serious. And a priest. And
and an Irishman.
Yeah. No, but we're all set up there. And this picture, even though it's kind of hard to tell from the depth of it, right past, I mean, like right over these little rocks right here is like a 1,000-foot drop. So you can't go any further. I mean, you have to, I had that's the 14 to 24 millimeter, so I had to get pretty close. And so we're all set up, and we've been there since 5 in the morning waiting for this golden light to hit the bottom of the arch. And right when the sun hits, from behind us, these three dreadlocked kids, probably 18-year-old kids, that looking like they spent 5 hours choosing how to look, as Rastafarian as white kids from the suburbs can look. They come up and with like video cameras and sound booms, and this hot little, Burning Man chick with her golden hula hoop that she had sprayed golden. She comes up and she puts her hoop right in the middle of all of us, right in the middle of the arch. And she kneels into the hoop, and she raises her hands out, as if she's like bowing to the sun god under the arch. And this is all in my shot, And so I don't want to be – actually, well, that's not true. I do want to be a jerk, but I didn't want to be in that moment. And so I just kind of sat there for a little while, and I thought, well, she'll get out. She's not going to stay there. But they never did. She just kept bowing and prostrating herself, and this guy's running around – like Andy Warhol's capturing the most amazing thing ever, and filming this girl with their little golden hula hoop. And so I was like, hey, is there any way you could back up like 3 feet, to get out of my shot? And that was it. I broke the magic, and they all left. So I ruined their moment. I ruined their moment. But then later, like 2 hours later, I'm leaving, and there's all kinds of cool stuff. So I was down on the ground, literally, like, on my stomach, and I'm shooting some little cactus, and I hear some couple coming over the ridge arguing with each other, and it was them. It was the guy in the film, the guy with the camera and the hula hoop girl, and they're arguing about something he had asked her to do, which I never did catch what it was, but he's going, well, why won't you do it? And she's like, that's not my thing, man. I'm not doing that. And so they come over the ridge and they see me down on the ground staring at them. I'm literally like 3 feet away, and it was just the most awkward moment in the world. But it was incredible. So I'm sure they're in a Google Plus Hangout talking about this jerk that ruined their special moment with the sun god. But so that was that story. All right, so let's scroll forward. I just want to show one more. I don't want to dominate this whole section here. There's a shot of a thunderhead, Dave. If you'll just kind of scroll forward till you find this big, big white cloud with that's a big old pano. And let's see.
Can I add a GT of remote? Just a question. I don't want to sound ignorant. I'm starting to do a few more panos here.
It's way too late for you not to sound ignorant.
That's true. I'm just not used to all this love on these hangouts. I'm standing at a few more panos, and I haven't really studied up on it that much. I just fang them through Photoshop. Is there any way, does anyone know, is there a way in which any product out there which takes your nefs from, so, oh, go away, takes your customers who needs them, we'll stitch together the actual nefs so they can then bring them back into Lightroom and then be working on the raws, on the raw files. Is there such a thing, or is that sort of my dream?
Well, I don't know.
No, once you take it out of raw of anything, it's not raw anymore.
Mm.
Yeah. But you can keep it like 16-bit or something and basically
have, that's what I'm doing. But I just thought it'd be an amazing thing if you could actually somehow combine raws into these mega files and be playing with it. It must be the next thing.
They would take a Pixar render farm to edit those files. I mean, oh god!
It already feels like it does. But, yeah. No, you're right. Okay, sorry. Back to you, Gina. Hey, just stole your thunder, mate.
Is this the shot, Gina?
Turnaround's fair play. Yeah, that one right there is another example of not having data that you didn't know when you're looking at in the camera. It did not obviously. All those little rain showers coming down out of that thunderhead, you could see them in person. But when you look in the camera at the raw files, they were gone. You couldn't see them. So then when I got back and then you start, manipulating it through some software and whatnot, kind of like Dallas was talking about, I was showing them to a friend of mine. I was going, look at the difference between straight out of camera and then, messing around with a little bit, look at all, you can actually, in the original one out of the camera, you couldn't see the rain coming down at all. It just didn't show up. And he seemed so disappointed. He was like, oh, so you just manipulated the picture so that you could see that. Oh, okay, that's kind of crappy. And, I was just blown away by it. I was like, it's funny you're talking about Ansel Adams. I said, yeah, that's how I feel about Ansel Adams, too. You know, the way he would dodge and burn things, I just lost all respect for him, But so it's just funny how people think that photoshopping is like cheating somehow or another.
Just a question. Did Ansel Adams ever say anything about the dishes? Did he have one of those?
Yeah. Well, he did to me. Yeah, that guy, I'll tell you one thing about him. Him and Hunter S. Thompson, I'll never have them over again. They were pigs.
Oh, and Johnny Depp, of course, because he was in your last shot.
Who's that?
Johnny Depp, he was in your last show.
I don't know the man. But hey, Dave, one more. If you can go back to one of those pony shots, go back to the big group and then the little pinto horse. That's the big horse. There's another one that's got a little, it's a little pinto, little colt.
Is this some donkey show?
Yeah, we're down in Mexico. And no. But anyway, this little pony... this little colt, he was the first one I saw down in Monument Valley. And like I said, that's the moon. That's actually the moon up there in the right-hand corner. And so I wanted to get low enough, because it was a little tiny pony, colt, I should say, not pony. But I wanted to get down low so that I could shoot up at it and get the moon and the mesa and get all those elements. And he kept moving away, obviously. He wasn't comfortable with this big fat crab from Texas mm-hmm. crawling up to him and trying to get his shot. And so finally, he was just kind of curious enough that he sat there. And Trey, you'll know, because you've got the 14 to 24 millimeter, how close I was to the pony for him to look that big. I was literally probably 6 to 10 inches away from his nose to get that shot. And I don't have it here, but I do have one of the shots. I was just firing away because I thought any second now he's going to run away. But I stuck my hand out to see how close I was and touched him on the nose, and that was it. He after I touched him, he bolted. But that's an example of that 14 to 24, about just how much data you can pull in. And all these shots are just dark. It was just a big black mess when I got home. And that's why I ended up making that one a black and white, too, just because there really wasn't enough color to make it worthwhile. Excellent. But anyway, those are some of the shots. And that whole little group of pictures, I think there's 24 of them, which we won't look at anymore. But they're on Google+ in my last post. So if you're interested in any of those, you can go check them out.
I sense you're a fan of ponies.
Yeah, I have a My Little Pony right over here collection. And I brush their hair. It's awesome.
A brony.
Hashtag bronies.
And in all seriousness, some lovely shots there, Gina.
Thank you.
Who's up for sharing next? I've got about five to share. I think everybody does, though. Do you have the little spinner wheel of death, Dave, you can pull up?
Give me a minute.
And thanks for showing those, Dave.
No problem, man.
Yes, well done, Dave.
That's what I'm here for. Let's see.
Mel, I know you have some good stuff to show, yes?
In that closet.
I will totally go next. Yeah, that's all a bunch of books. And
sure
it
is.
Stuff that I can't tell you. Yeah. Yeah, no, I will totally go next if nobody else wants to go.
Yes, you can go next while Dave hooks up our wheel of certain color death.
That's
see.
Right.
But make sure you go totally next, though.
I'll go. Well, I've got good examples of what it takes to bring a photo from a snapshot, I guess, with, you know, I don't know. I don't have stories about all of my photos, but I do have stories about how I got to all the photos, okay? So I work with kids and with art in my day job. And I have been asked for a really long time by my kids, what do you do? And I say, I'm a photographer. And they say, well, what do you do for art? You know, for a long time, I just kind of said, I take photos, you know, right? Well, I recently, Nick, I've told you about this a few times, and I swear I keep pushing back my deadline, but I decided I wanted to try to sell or to take, you know, my photos and turn them into something more art, something in between craft and fine art. So it's a really big line, but I didn't want to just send prints off, have somebody print them, send it back, frame them, and give them out. So I've been trying to get this process down of hand mounting prints onto board. And I'm using canvas board now, but I have tried, I've tried so many different boards, so many different adhesives, so many different textures on them. I mean, I've played with it, and it's been really fun, but I think I finally have the process down. And I'm going to try to start selling just via Etsy. Now this is where it gets funny, because I said June 1st, and then that didn't happen because I got really busy. So then I was like, June 17th or whatever. Yeah, it didn't work either. So now I'm like, by fall, by September 1st, that's my new goal. But so what I've been doing, and you guys can probably, this is like super prototype, but I'm taking and I'm mounting, I'm painting the backs, I'm mounting them, I'm adding just a light texture so it doesn't just look, each one looks different. I've got hanging space. I don't know. They're working. They're fun. It's a really relaxing process to take something that I've worked on, I've shot. I've basically taken from a piece of nature to a shot. I've post-processed it. I've had it printed. Then I'm taking it back into my own hands and creating something else. So the only good thing that has come out of my inability to get my stuff together has been the fact that I've been able to put together kind of a cool series of flowers. So this is where I go back to what happens. I've never shot flowers before. This is the first time I've ever done it. And flowers, when you shoot them, I mean, everybody's like, oh, look at this beautiful flower shot I have. You can see each petal. And it's like, yes, you can. It's awesome. And I've seen it before, and it's gorgeous, but I really wanted to take something with my flowers and just kind of add a little bit more, let me see if I can pull these up. I just wanted to add a little bit more drama to them or a little bit more of a mood to them. Are you guys able to see it? I can't see it yet.
Yeah, we can see it. Well, we saw it for a second.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah,
okay.
This,
so basically, I'm just sharing through Google Plus just because I am not on my computer, so we're going to just use this. It's easier.
It's a very colorful browser you have.
I know, right? I'm going to have to change it. I'm kind of tired of it, actually. But, so I've been just taking flowers bit by bit. And this is where it comes down to, I'm not using anything but Lightroom to take and to just, I'm not doing much to change them other than playing with the light that I've captured naturally. And it doesn't take a ton, but it does take it, you know, it does take time to kind of find the personality of the flower. or the weed and to work with it. But so these are the primary my series that I'm working on. And together, I've actually got them all hung up together with my prototypes.
Ooh.
This I was so angry at, and I sat down on the ground and I pouted because I couldn't get a shot because the bug wouldn't stay still that I was trying to shoot, and I was so angry. And I sat down and I pouted for a second, like 3-year-old, and then I found that it was so worth it. But so yeah, so this is what I've been working on, and it's so fun to get these back and to take it from, you know, from sitting up my yard or, you know, hiking to, you know, I mean, it goes a long way with me, and it's been really a fun process, I have to say.
Do you think as you know, working as an artist, yeah, and stuff with kids in that in general, like getting away from the digital stuff, taking everything and going back, yeah, to here's, I'm, my hands are getting dirty, like I'm actually, yeah, doing something.
It's a,
is,
yeah, it's a physical process, and really, I mean, art to me, it's being a photographer. I'm terrible at painting and at drawing, doing all of those things, but to me, I can take a photo and turn it into something more, and that comes pretty easily after practice, of course, but yeah, kids, though, it's the kids that got me thinking about this. They're like, well, what do? I take pictures. That's not art. And it's like, to them, it's not. To them, art is a piece of paper that goes home. So now when they ask, I have something to show them. And to say, I made this, my hands are painted, I have a stain on my shirt, I have, you know, like, I mean, for a while, I had adhesive stuck in the bottom of my hair. I had to cut a chunk out because, you know, that's from making this, though. And it's, so to me, it's, I don't know, it's just kind of a meditative thing, almost. And it really connects me in a way that I've never connected to my photography before. And
kids
just
can be so cruel, can't they?
Yeah, I love them. I love them.
Imagine
they kick my butt. Yeah.
Yeah, you come back with your piece of art and you're like, what do you do for art?
God. I made this. Boom! You like swing it at him or something.
Well, the thing that you've got to remember is, number one, you're bigger and stronger than them, so you can always hit. You can hit them. And yeah, two is, kids are stupid. So
oh, they're so much more creative than I am naturally, though, and they are so inspiring to me when they say stuff like this. Part of me is like, shut up. I worked really hard on the shot that I did last night and then edited on a computer while watching, you know, Three's Company. Okay, I'm not going to lie. But, you know, they don't see it like that. So they've really pushed me, and it's connected me to my artistic route.
Al, you should have Gino come into your class and speak as a motivational speaker.
Yeah.
All I see are, like, all these kids hanging off of his limbs, beating him somehow. It'd be awful.
I'll do my Farley imitation. I live in a van down by the river.
And they'd look at you and be like, what? What are you doing? It would be awesome.
Yeah.
If you
know, even Mel is too young for that one.
Oh, no.
Oh.
God, no.
I don't think you got my Purify Your Soul in the Waters of Lake Minnetonka reference from Purple Rain earlier either. So.
You know, and that's so bad. I just don't like Prince. And being from Minneapolis, I should like him just because, but I just don't like the man. He's short.
Oh, yeah. I hate short people, too.
Like, really, I've seen him. Like, in real life, he's just little. And
I did not see that coming.
I'm so sorry, guys.
Keith Barrett?
Sorry.
How tall are you, Keith Barrett?
5'11".
Oh, you're totally fine. Prince
is that tall
five
enough for you, Mel?
Two or something. Oh,
Gino.
Yeah. Perfect.
Gino, how tall are you not to be hated?
Yeah, hey, are there any more prejudices you just want to throw out there? I mean, this is interesting. Go ahead. You don't like people with curly hair, fair-skinned people?
Must be at least this tall not to be hated.
Yes, right, no.
So I don't like Prince people either, but it has nothing to do with his height.
Anyway, Dave, did you find that spinner of death? It looks like you did.
Oh, look, she's changing the subject. Nice.
I don't like spinners of death either, just so you guys
actually
know.
I just wanted to say something along with what Mel was saying about, like, making the pictures. Actually, when I first started doing photography in college, and it was a darkroom class, mm-hmm, my professor or lecturer at the time, Stan, he said, like, I don't like it when people say that they take pictures, because taking sounds, mm-hmm, like stealing, like, and that has a negative connotation. So, you know, if you're doing photography as an art, say that you're making pictures.
Yeah,
And that's really stuck with me over the years. So.
And I think that gets lost with digital age because people just really feel like they're taking it, put it on their computer, and they're done. Or, you know, they edit it, put it out for everybody to see, and they're done. But, you know, now that we don't shoot film and we don't process it by hand, you know, typically, it just, you kind of lose that connection with your art. At least I think so, but I also have kids telling me that I suck.
By the way, you should look into caustic beeswax. That's a thing that a lot of people have been doing with their pictures. Like, you put a layer
What's
of beeswax.
What's that?
Google
Ooh.
It. Caustic
I will.
Beeswax.
Yeah. I've been wanting to try it, but they'll like mount their photos onto boards and then put wax over it so it like distorts the photo and you can scrape it away and everything. So it's pretty
also
cool.
Also works wonders on rashes. I can tell you that.
Especially when it's boiling hot.
All right, Dave.
Wow.
We have your wheel of death there. Why is my name so big with my avatar there?
Well, because I had it pre-configured for the last time and had all the faces and stuff. And
oh. Okay, so only mine is... Okay, it seems weird. As long as it's not weighted to my color. Okay, we got three people left to share photos. They have Nick, me, and Dallas. All right, so we've got too many colors on here.
Oh, so, that will do us. I thought this was a crowdsourced hotometer, and I was
You want
six.
Me to remove or just...
Yeah, it could be a crowdsourced hotometer. We should do that next time. Very smart. Okay, so anyway, I'm white. Dallas, you're yellow or orangish.
Why am I not white?
You're yellow. Okay, spin it again. They'll just win.
Yeah. And
where
Nick, you're
Nobody
short.
Only Dave can get the line.
Go again.
It's on Trey for me.
Well,
it's on the line here.
No, I see it on purple. Oh, now I see it's on me. All right.
Oh, it was delayed.
Okay, let me unscreen share. Okay, I'm going to go screen share to my thing. Oh, by the way, here's the what we're doing.
You take pictures too, Trey?
Yes, sometimes.
Oh, that's a shame. You should not take pictures, Trey.
He creates photos.
Yeah, it's negative, isn't it?
Yeah, so I know. That and plus Aborigines don't like it because they think you're taking their soul.
Yeah,
especially
I don't know
the short
life without that kind of advice.
Yeah.
So today what we're going to do right after we share our photos is we'll do our Google Plus discoveries. We all brought a few people that you might want to follow, and we'll plus mention them as well. And I'm still watching comments, and so is Dave, on Stuck in Customs and on Google Plus and everywhere. So we're reading everything you guys are writing, so keep it coming. All right. So screen share. Let me go to my iPhoto here.
Has anybody said anything positive about me, Trey? Because my mom is supposed to be in the chat room.
No, I haven't seen much about you at all, which is a shocker.
Yeah.
How about his mom?
Yeah.
No, nothing from his mom either. Well, all right, can you guys see that?
I never liked her anyway.
All right, let me share my screen here. Okay, so I took this about a week ago here over the lake. It was my first day taking the kids to school. I had just dropped them off at school there at Queenstown Primary, and I had to go downtown to sign some legal papers. And while I was down there, it was raining like crazy, and I had my D3S with me because I was just taking pictures of the kids as they were going to school and that sort of thing. And, you know, I didn't have the right lens, of course. You never do. I had the 28-300 on, which isn't really made for shooting rainbows. And I had it in the continuous high mode, which is super fast on the D3S. And I held it vertically, and I just held it down and sprayed across horizontally. And that got... I think it ended up with about 14 shots, and I pulled them all into Lightroom, all the RAWs in the Lightroom, and then I processed one of them so that it looked good, and I synced it across all the others, then I exported them, and I merged them all in Photoshop to make one panorama. And anyway, it's okay, I guess. It's not that great, because I think the sky is a little boring, but I guess that's maybe not so bad, because it doesn't take away from the rainbow. And anyway.
Well,
I think
you know, in some ways, Trey, in some ways, using that lens was a good thing, because one thing I found out on this trip is that the 14 to 24, because it's got so much vignetting, it doesn't really lend itself for stitching later.
Yeah, that's true, although I still ended up with some pretty hardcore vignetting, and that photo merge on Photoshop is so smart, man. It really cleaned it up.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's that one. This is one that I took down a few months ago in Virgin Gorda in the Caribbean, and there was this pathway here. This is about probably a quarter mile long, and it came from this little private house we were staying at called Toad Hall. And so we have this private path that goes through all these boulders and caves and everything, and it ends up here on this beach where you're pretty much totally alone almost all the time, but especially, you know, around sunset and sunrise, there's just nobody there. One thing you can't tell from this, and it wasn't necessarily something I was trying to achieve with the photo, but this stops about, I don't know why they built it like this, but it stops about 5 feet from the ground. So once you get to the end of the path, you got to figure out how to get actually down to the ground. And it's not that bad if you're, you know, grown up, but we had like 3 kids we had to get off this thing. So it was quite a maneuver to try to get everyone down off this.
Another reason not to like short people.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Here's one. This is on the way from right out of Queenstown on the way down to Glenarchy. And I know Todd will attest to this. People will probably, outsiders would think that I change all these colors around. But, you know, there's certain times of the day when the lake is at a certain level of calmness when, I mean, the colors are just, you know, completely outrageous.
No, you photoshopped that, mate.
Ah!
Photoshop.
No,
you're right, Trent.
You know, it is definitely an HDR shot. You can see some of the HDR artists here inside some of the colors that are falling off the mountains and some of the texture in the clouds.
No, it does. It does look like that. You're right.
Yeah. And, there is just this weird, you know, I don't know, it's not quite this Caribbean or this Greek blue, but it's like this deep water cold blue. And it's just wild. Okay.
So that's just amazing.
Just making it up there, Trey.
It's insane, yeah. Isn't it, when you drive around the road and you come around that corner and see that, isn't it? The first time, it just blows you away every time, doesn't it?
You never get used to it, yeah.
No.
Actually, right down here, there's a new area where all these Hollywood people are moving in. So here, this is in Dallas's neck of the woods. This is on Maui. I was out here with Tom, and
Oahu.
Oh, I'm sorry, Oahu, not Maui. I apologize.
Although I'm from Maui. But.
And this is I was over on the edge of another cliff. I had just kind of finished shooting for the day, and I had to go relieve myself, and I figured it'd be okay to go off the cliff. And while I was over there, I noticed this girl fishing. So I set up. Let me zoom in on her.
So how much of that water was in the shot before you relieved yourself?
This is it's pretty consistent amount, I'd say, before and after.
All right.
Yeah. So anyway, I kind of like this, the way this one turned out. I don't do a lot of up and down type shots, but I was happy with this one. This is the first summer out of the last 5 summers that I have not spent, you know, several weeks in Iceland. So I'm kind of missing that time a little bit, but, you know, I've been busy with the move and that sort of thing, so that's my excuse. But I took this last summer when I was in Iceland, just about this same time, and yeah, there's just, you know, thousands of these little places all around.
Now, is that a really old little structure there, or is it just because of the weather that they get really beaten down quickly?
I don't know. I don't know how old it is, but the winds just do beat up stuff prematurely.
They just look gorgeous. I love all your Iceland shots.
Thank you. And the last one is one more.
Amazing.
This one is this is what it must have looked like, you know, for the ancient seafarers of yore, as they came into the southern coast of New Zealand. This is shot from the Tasman Sea, and this is going into a Milford Sound, which is really just a fjord. You know, fjords and sounds are the same thing. They just call them sounds here. And it's really, really beautiful down there. I haven't had a chance to go down for a while, but I hope to get down there in the near future.
Great compression. I love the compression there.
Oh, thank you.
Hey, yeah, Todd, can you say fjord real quick?
Do I have to?
No, just one time for the kids.
Fjord.
Thank you.
Do you pronounce it with a J?
I try not to say it, but you can just read the phone book, Todd, and I'll just be amused.
You've been getting some comments here actually on the Hangout actually, Gino. You've made it big. There's a few there for you.
Oh, now my mom and my sister. Good.
Well, there's some guy there saying that he's your son. Anyway.
Oh, well, that's always a possibility in every port, you know.
All right, spin that wheel one more time. We've only got two people left, Nick and Dallas. Where it lands, nobody knows. It doesn't seem to spin. It just points randomly.
Yeah, it's the refresh. Like it's so little. Yeah. Just so little of it moving.
Yeah.
This is Gino.
Gino, he's landing
Dallas
on you.
Wins.
All right, Dallas, smack dab in the middle. You look like you're in heaven, Dallas. Dallas, over. Dallas, hang out to Dallas.
Oh. Dallas, we have a
They're trying to fix. They're trying to fix it in the chat.
Whoa.
Wait, I think they're back. Are they back?
There. Now they're back. Okay. Well, Nick, this is me. That is your turn. We'll make it their Hawaii act together.
Sorry.
Sorry about that.
I'll say it again. Okay. They're back.
Oh, is it my turn?
Not anymore.
Okay. That's okay.
All right.
We'll go to you.
Even worse for last.
Let's see. Make sure I'm doing that right.
By the way, Nick, we're getting many comments. People are very happy that you and Mel are on. You're always mentioned in combination with Mel for some reason. But anyway,
I was so nervous.
Two of you are on.
And I was so nervous, and then I saw Nick was on, and it just made it all go away. I'm like, yes, all right, I can do this.
we seem to share a large group of friends, I think.
Yeah.
I tend to mostly shoot macro stuff, and That's not the only thing I shoot, but I'm not much of a landscape guy or anything like that. But I tend to, I would say, break as many rules as I can. So most things I don't shoot with a tripod. I just shoot handheld. And it's just because for me it's a process that works a little better. So I like to hike and go outdoors and do that kind of thing. So a lot of what I shoot is the things that I find when I'm out. So I try to look for patterns, look for things that I think a lot of people would typically just walk past in a lot of cases. And even something like this is another example of rule breaking. I think most people probably try not to shoot birds with macro lenses, but I'll sit there and do it. I'll try to make that happen. And you know, sometimes it takes 30 minutes to sit there and get close enough to get a shot like that. But
it's something that, at least for me, just in my life in general, I tend to try and slow down and operate that way. So for photography, it's kind of another release for me from that. So, and again, you know, things like this where this particular dragonfly just happened to land on this styrofoam cup. So it's probably kind of hard to see in the hangout, but the pattern of the styrofoam kind of mirrors the pattern of the wings, and that's the kind of thing that I think a lot of people would maybe okay. just overlook. And
that's pretty cool, Nick.
I tried to look for that kind of thing when I'm out and about. So again, you know, just
wow.
more of that kind of stuff that I think is interesting, and yeah, in a lot of cases I shoot things that just make me happy. I don't really have a goal a lot of the time. I just go out and try to find things that I think when I come home I'm gonna look at and be proud of. So. You know,
that shot that you just blew by of the thorn was really beautiful. That's great.
It was amazing, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite ones recently, and a lot of that is, you know, trying to isolate things, which again for me kind of goes back to even something like this first shot where, you know, I really try to focus on that leaf and isolate that from its surroundings. So, at least in a lot of my shots, I think that sort of theme carries through. And again, you know, I don't set out just to do that. I do shoot a lot of macro, but you know, if I see an interesting building or a pattern on a wall or something like that, I'll stop and shoot it. You know, even to the point of walking around. You know, downtown shooting buildings and that kind of thing.
That's pretty clever, that one.
And then I do try to create shots as well, which in a lot of cases, some of these are from the scavenger hunt, which I know you guys had a show about that here recently. So I do
that
try
last,
to...
That last shot is garbage.
Rubbish, right? Rubbish.
Rubbish. Mm.
Ah, sorry.
But I try to set things up, and I look for contrast, you know. So you have an image like this where you have something as gritty and just awful as that dumpster. It's filthy and terrible.
And you didn't set that up? Those balloons were just attached to the dumpster there?
No, that's actually one that I did set up, and okay. I tried. I do try to do that, though. I try to...
You have manipulated the shot before you even took it into Lightroom. That's genius.
Something like that.
It's like using a density filter. Ah.
But again, you know, things like this where I try to set things up for the last round of the scavenger hunt. One of the categories was shallow depth of field. So, you know, my mental process is, okay, what's the most narrow thing I can try to shoot, and I settled on hair, and shooting a piece of hair is not the most interesting thing. So, you know, what can I do to amplify that or make it more visually impactful? And so set up a shot like that.
It's amazing how much your personality comes out, and not just you, but in general, you can kind of tell a lot about a person by what they choose to shoot, and that's definitely true when we're looking at these shots that you've chosen to show us here.
I appreciate that. I do feel like that's at least as far as like style goes. I don't really mm-hmm. have to try and set up a specific style, but I think that comes through in a lot of my photos, even though there's such a variety in what I shoot in a lot of cases.
A lot of people don't know, but Ansel Adams used a lot of balloons in his shots, too.
So. Mm.
Yeah.
Black and white ones.
Rare anthology.
Yeah, carrying on the great tradition.
Yeah, Balloons of America, I think is what it was called.
He shot a lot of rubbish, too. You got to realize that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I love that one, Nick.
So, yeah, and again, this was for one of the scavenger hunts. The category was orange, so... You know, rather than just try to shoot something that's orange, even in Orange itself. How can I make it a little different? What can I do that's, wow, that's a little more...
Did you win?
Actually, with that one, I did. I came in first in the...
Is that just orange paint?
Yeah, it was just orange paint.
Oh, I thought it was caramel this whole time.
Yeah, that was kind of...
Yeah. It kind of
has that effect a little bit, which I thought was kind of cool.
Yeah. Food.
But that was part of it. I mean, that wasn't my original goal in shooting that shot, but it does look that way, and I think it works for that as well. But again, like my process, in a lot of cases, goes something like this. And this isn't my photo. This is Kim Pemberton's photo, and I saw this photo a long time ago, and I just loved it. And for me, it's okay. How did Kim shoot this? What did she do? And I'll just try something. I'll try to duplicate a shot. And I'm not exactly duplicating this shot, but I'll take something like that and then go here. So I take her shot. I learn from it. See what I can do. See how it's been accomplished, and then try to take that to my own place as well. So I end up at the strawberry. So then I end up here with this razor blade, which I had the razor blades left over from before. So again, just kind of combining and pulling ideas together, and trying to create something that's unique. And I think that's something that a lot of people do, even if maybe they don't necessarily realize it. A lot of the time, you have your influences and people that you look up to. And
you don't want to use Kim Pemberton as an influence or someone to look up to, though. Come on, let's be honest. she'll take you to dark places.
But very dark places. No.
That's a great shot, though. That razor blade shot. I know we're joking around everything, but that's wonderful.
All right, I appreciate it. But like I said, I think it's just it's that, and I think in a lot of cases, people, like I said, don't necessarily realize that they do that with things. So we're here on Google+. We see hundreds, if not thousands, of photos every week and every day in a lot of cases. And even if you don't necessarily pick up on something right off, it's these little bits of things that get stuck in the back of your mind, and you're shooting later and you draw from those. And so I think that's a big part of how I operate as a photographer, I think it's cool to acknowledge that sometimes as well. So
speaking of dark places, Gino, see, Sandra Parlow has just suggested that you and I are having a bromance, that you have a crush on me.
Well, right off the bat,
it just doesn't get dark on that, man. That does not. That is too dark. Sandra, shame on you.
Yeah. Well, there's no question. First of all, I want that's absolutely true. So that's just to get that out of the way. And you notice Trey.
Reciprocal.
Trey moves all the way out to your neck of the woods. You think that's on accident? Now he's having you in his hangouts. Come on, what's going on here? I think it's pretty obvious.
I think it'll be the last after my failed attempt at humor calling with the Ansel Adams and rubbish thing there. That's gone badly.
Oh, you tried to do some humor earlier? I missed it.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
No, it's all right.
Yeah.
Don't worry.
I'm getting some Ansel anger here, so yeah.
No worries. I've also said a few things that'll make Ansel Adams spin around in his black and white grave. All right, so Dallas, you're the only one left.
Okay.
Regale us with some JPEG awesomeness.
Okay, hold on. I actually brought 10 pictures. I'm sorry. I'll scroll through the first five real fast because they're kind of related.
So, okay. Let's
see. And then.
No.
They're first cousins.
Okay.
Let the dog talk about them.
Toda.
She's sleeping. anyway, last time we did a hangout, I had shared a bunch of fashion images, but a lot of people seemed to go for more of the landscape with this audience, so I tried to bring more landscapes. And I was lucky enough to be invited by the U.S. Pacific Fleet to go up to Midway Atoll for the 70th anniversary of the Battle of Midway in the beginning of June. And because of the nesting albatross, they're only allowed to land and take off from the island when it's completely dark. So poor me, I had to spend an entire day on Midway Atoll. And it was just the craziest, coolest place I've been yet because it's, you know, very, very secluded, very few people. The wildlife was everywhere and did not care if you go walking up to them. And so it was some really good picture opportunities. And so you guys see the first picture?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this one is an HDR that I shot of their old hangar bay, which is by their harbor. And that's actually the moon in the background, and then the foreground is being lit by the earliest sunlight coming up, because this is shortly after we landed. And I thought it was cool. It was one of the buildings that was attacked during the Battle of Midway.
Really?
And, yeah, and they've never really, like, really repaired it. It's fallen into disrepair, and they have no plans on trying to fix it up, so it's just this busted-up old building.
I thought it was a Texaco.
It's actually, it was the hangar for their seaplanes, because there was a seaplane ramp.
Wow. We should probably note at this point that Midway has been entirely converted to a
fish and wildlife
reserve. So, again, like no reason to repair the military building, save for the ones that they're using for their preservation mission.
And, yeah, so this is the first picture I like really set up to shoot. I had a nice guy driving me around the island on a golf cart because there's no cars. It's all golf carts because they can weave around the birds that sit in the roads because they won't move for anything, so you have to dodge around them. And here's one of the birds. This is a young albatross chick, but starting to get some adult feathers in, so they weren't super tiny and fluffy when I was there. And then there's actually a bokeh-out silhouette of an older albatross on the horizon line. And this is just shot with my 24 1.4 super shallow depth of field wide angle as the sun was coming up. And again, with the bringing back Lightroom shadows, I mean, this is only shot with my old 5D Mark II, but it did an okay job of bringing back some shadow detail because I wasn't about to start flashing native birds in the face of the strobe or anything.
Plus, they're short.
Yeah. And so here's a long exposure HDR that I did of one of the piers at sunrise from Midway. Again, just, you know, finding interest in the textures and the colors and how abandoned everything is. And then later in the day, after the ceremonies, we got to just go explore the island on our own. So this is a view of the beach that faces towards the inner atoll, so where it's really shallow. And I don't know how well you can see it on Hangout, but in the upper right corner, there's red-tailed tropic birds all flying, and there was, like, thousands of them probably flying all overhead. And then what I really loved about this was that the color of the water is so brilliant that the bottoms of the clouds and the white birds are all turquoise, like, as you're just standing there watching it.
I thought it was really cool.
And that's from the light reflecting off the water is actually coloring the birds?
If you looked at my pictures of them, and I have a bunch on my blog on dallasnagatawhite.com, sometimes the underside of the white birds or the clouds would just be turquoise tinted in the pictures because of the color of the water.
Really cool.
Yeah. And then, here is a picture. It's not HDR. It's actually just processed in Lightroom of the Eastern Island, because Sand Island at Midway is where all the people stay and work. And then Eastern Island just has a few manned structures left. And then
you can see one of them here.
Yes, yeah, as you can see, this is a gun remaining from the military days. But it's been left to the birds otherwise. And so this is just a view of how many albatross chicks are at Midway when you're just walking around. And times that by, like, 100, and that's on both islands. It's just crowded like that. So it was pretty cool. And they kind of snap their beaks at you as you walk by, but they won't actually attack you. They might pull at your shoelace or something, but they're pretty fun to watch and interact with.
Dallas said that it sounded like you were being sarcastically slow-clapped the entire time you were on the island.
Yeah, because the clacking beak sounded like clapping. And then towards the end of the day, we had dinner near the beach, and then I ran out with another photographer friend to shoot some sunset pictures. And so I really liked just the colors of this one. Like, that beach was the most spectacular beach I've ever been to. And just how calm and clear the water is, and the clouds and everything. Although apparently there's a bunch of spinner dolphins that live in the water out there, and while I was more inland shooting other birds, they were putting on a big show for everybody, and of course I missed it. So just hopefully find a way to go back someday. Okay, let's see. Okay, and switching gears, I shoot fashion, so I have to show some fashion. I have been experimenting lately with using things in front of the lens. For this shot, the red and the blue are actually from holding some flash gels on either side of my lens when shooting, and I've been playing with like how that affects the picture in camera and then what I can do with it afterwards. So I didn't color that blue or red in post. It actually was like that to begin with. And this is part of an Americana theme shoot that I did to launch my blog, because I relaunched it on the 4th of July. And then, let's see. And so here's a shot that we shot in Waikiki while crossing the street. And again, this time I was holding not actual flash gels, but cellophane, colored cellophane in front of the lens. So that's much more distorting and warped the image, and I kind of liked the effect. I thought it was an interesting way to spotlight stuff with color in a analog manner. I had, actually the blue came out pretty good, but I had to bring out the red color a little bit more in post.
Yeah, you keep getting that same girl like walking into your shot. It's so rude.
I know, right?
Yeah, totally.
At least she's dressed well.
Yeah.
And then finally, here's a shot that I did, which was a funny story. We had actually had a miscommunication in the times we needed to get ready to do this shot, because in Honolulu, in Waikiki, every Friday at the same time, they have a mini fireworks show. So the show lasts about 3 minutes, and so we were aiming to get there, but didn't calculate for the traffic trying to go into Waikiki at the time. So we did a detour and got dropped off and ran out onto a bunch of rocks where we thought we might get a view of it. And as I was still setting up my tripod for the shot, the fireworks already started going off. And, you know, I'm freaking out, and I'm telling my assistant, like, you know, set the flash to this. And I managed to get off 13 frames during the fireworks show. And luckily, because this model is spectacular, we got 9 usable frames out of the 13.
Wow.
Which I was super impressed with. I was like, wow, good job, team. Like, we had to do minimal adjustment and only had a couple minutes to shoot, but we got it.
A shout out goes to Jay for also being like super on it with the light.
Yeah, Jay Scotty, he's awesome, my awesome assistant. Okay, and then finally, I took a shot just for you guys the other night after I found out I was going to be doing this.
Whoa.
So this one's for you guys, because I was like, well, I'll do a landscape and I'll do a starscape. So, and this is actually inspired by the Google Plus photographer that I'm going to be sharing later, because he just went to the Big Island and shot some awesome Milky Way pictures, which I'll show you guys later. But so I was thinking about stars, you know, and I'd actually been shooting the Milky Way 2 weekends ago, because it's been unusually clear. Like, maybe I just haven't noticed it, but it's been really clear on Oahu, even though there's a lot of light pollution. And we could actually see the Milky Way. I'm used to only seeing it on Maui or the Big Island. So this was late night after Ed and I were done shooting a wedding in Waikiki, and we were driving home, and we saw that it was pretty clear, so we pulled over and did some night shots, and this was my favorite one.
Do you remember what your settings were, like how long or anything?
Yeah, I usually shoot 30 seconds when I'm shooting wide, because, you know, they'll barely start to drag, but it's not noticeable on the wide. I think this is at 16. The horizon's a little crooked because it was really dark, so it's hard for me to frame my shot, and then if I straighten the horizon, I'd lose rocks at the bottom, so I just left it.
And your ISO, do you remember?
1600.
Okay.
I knew I wanted to pull back detail in the rocks, so I didn't want to have too much grain, so
right,
I felt
right.
1600 was a good middle ground to go for. And then it was at 2.8.
Job well done.
Yeah. Very cool. Thank you. Thank you, Dallas. Thanks for taking a special photo just for the show.
Yes.
More people should do that. Okay. Gino, I noticed you didn't do that, Gino.
I know. Now, way to make me feel like a loser, Trey.
God.
What did you bring to the show, Gino? Nothing.
Okay, so let's do our little Google Plus discoveries, and then we'll call it a day or a night, depending on where you are. I'll start with my little Google Plus discovery. And again, this isn't a discovery for me, maybe not for some of you, but I want you guys to go and circle her up. Let me screen share here. And the reason I circle her up is it is her birthday, and she's a good photographer. This is Tamara. A lot of people might know her from around Google+. This is her on the right there with her little coquettish pose. She's an astronaut's wife. And she does all kinds of great photography. She's into these macro kind of floral type stuff. She's sort of a digital Georgia O'Keeffe of sorts. And anyway, she's definitely worth circling up if she has somehow been a black spot in your knowledge of Google Plus photographers. Okay, so let me see a screen share.
She's also trending on Google Plus right now, too.
She's trending.
Yeah, her happy birthday camera is trending.
Oh, look at that. That's cool. all right, who wants to share next?
I don't mind.
Okay.
I've got somebody. I don't think you know. I think it'd be easy to say like Vivian Gouchois, the Gooch, you know. But everybody knows her, and she's awesome. By the way, she's got something. If you want to go check out her her profile, she's getting like something in the middle of Manhattan's big high def TV or something that's out there that's going to be showing all of her images. So that's pretty exciting for her. I think my best known but probably least appreciated for her great photography is Julia Peterson, the wife of Thomas Hawke.
Yes.
I don't think people get, or maybe they do, but she just doesn't get the credit because she's related or married to Thomas. But her work is amazing. I'm always impressed with it. But somebody that maybe y'all don't know about that I've really appreciated here lately. You know, it's easy. A lot of people taking pictures of puppies and flowers and, you know, Trey landscapes and HDRs. But there's somebody I've noticed on Google Plus who's taken something to an art form that I don't think anybody else has really thought about. And I don't know if you've ever heard of her, but her name's Lotus Carroll. And she has taken now over, I think it's something like 17,000 images in a row of herself. And it is just amazing, this art form, that she has taken this one subject and really dedicated herself to it. So if you guys don't know Lotus Carroll, go check her out. And, you know, I think you'll really appreciate the amazing work that she's doing with one subject.
I want to see some kind of collaboration between you and her, Gina. I want to see something maybe involving the bathroom and you... really, when you add Gino to the mix of a selfie, it doubles the possibilities, at least.
And some ponies, maybe.
Yeah. Well, I don't think anybody wants to be in a bathroom with me. I'm not going to get into the details of why, but not in your best interest. So, but anyway, I was just impressed. I don't know if anybody's ever seen her or not, but you might want to go check her out.
All right, thanks. Who wants to go next?
I'll go. All right, I'm going to share. And you guys, I have no idea how to say his last name. Maybe you guys can help me. How bad is that? Can you see Jason?
Jakober.
Is it Jakober? Is that
it?
It
must be. Yeah.
All right. He's all over the place lately, and then he's only got, I mean, it's a ton, but he's only got about 3,000 people following him, but for his work, he's amazing. Most people probably know him for his selfies, especially us chicks. We probably know him for that. He does pretty amazing stuff. He works a ton with lighting, a ton of different subjects, but then when you really go into his work, he does some really cool stuff, too, other than just selfies. I mean, it's some pretty fascinating stuff that he's done, other than his amazingly sexy selfies, but, you know. So he's my chair. If you haven't circled him, definitely, definitely worth a circle. And he's doing a 366 project, so he's got stuff every day. Definitely worth a circle.
All right. Thanks, Mel. Nick, you got something for us?
Yeah, right here. Screen share one.
Okay, and then we'll do Dallas, and then we'll end with a money shot with Todd.
Yeah. There we go. So I want to share Chris LaCour, and that's LaCour. And he is a really great photographer. I believe he's from Pennsylvania, if I remember correctly. But he just takes so many cool shots of things that that I just find fascinating, and a lot of them are even something like this with this frost. It's kind of a mundane subject in the sense that it's a parking lot, but it's just it looks so out of this world to me. I'm really kind of transported there when I see his photos, and I really love his processing style and that kind of thing too. But he's also very good at finding these unique patterns and things, which I think I'm attracted to, because in a lot of cases is what I try to do as well.
Yeah.
But he's also just has such a great eye for composition, even on something as simple as this shot. You know, it tells you a huge story, or even this circus shot. You know, if you look at it just quickly, you might just see legs, but if you really start to pay attention to the details, you see the faces in the background, you see the ring from the circus, and you start to get the story from the image itself. But he also shoots a lot of this kind of stuff too. It's just textures and patterns, things that that I really, really like. He also has quite a bit of range as well, so doing selfies and these other things, I think that he just does a wonderful job, and I think more people need to check him out. So.
Wow.
There we
cool.
go.
Good find, Nick. Thank you. All right, Dallas, you're up.
Okay.
Screen share.
Which one is it?
There it is.
Okay.
There we go. We figured it out.
Okay. So person we're sharing is actually one of our friends and fellow photographers in Hawaii, and lucky for Google Plus, we finally convinced him to get on Google Plus, so he barely has anybody following him right now. But
so go follow him. It'll be worth it,
yes,
we promise.
He's pretty awesome. His name is John Hook, and he shoots all sorts of things, but he shoots things that, like, no one else that I know. So
like, he's got a real sense of humor about his photographs, and just you know, incredible personality and uniqueness. Like, he uses techniques that, yeah, everybody else uses. Like, it's not, the techniques are nothing that you haven't seen before, but the way that he uses it all is just, you know, you see it and it tickles your brain, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah. So from breakfasty portraits to regular gorgeous portraits. And then recently, actually, let me get out of this. He did some shots with burning steel wool.
There's one of them.
And including this one.
And if you guys want to go do a quick Google, that's actually a remix of the Morton Salt Girl using burning steel wool.
Yeah. Also, I want to say that John shot this for a thing we have going on in Hawaii called photoboxing, which is run by local photographer Shane Gillard of Firebird Photography, and anyone in the world can sign up. But basically, if you Google photoboxing, you should find the website. And every week there's a theme, and two photographers face off with a limited amount of time on the theme to take photos. So it's kind of fun. You guys should really check that out. And
that's some of his more impressive work.
Yeah, here's some like night shots he did with light painting. And then recently, he went to the Big Island, like I said, and he took this picture that's him and his wife and daughter.
And that was our inspiration.
I love that. Okay,
isn't that amazing? Yeah.
Oh, it's so cool.
That was what was on our mind when we said we need to go shoot the Milky Way, because, man. So John's an inspiration to us. If you check out his Tumblr, handsomeunicorn.tumblr.com, I mean, like, just really, really funny stuff. Like, if you keep in mind that half of the stuff that he posts is just because he thinks it's funny, I mean, it's, you know, you will get a laugh every single time.
Yep. So, that's ours.
Cool, thanks. I just circled him up. And for everyone that's not sure who we're talking about, all these various things, I'll be sure to plus mention. Thanks, Dave. Dave Veffer really does all the hard work on that.
Yay, Dave.
So, thank you, Dave. Okay, Todd. Now,
right on.
Close with you. But before you give yours, there's a comment here from Sandra Parlow. She is very, maybe a little overexcited about your bromance.
I know.
Yeah.
She's that way inclined.
Yeah. This is, women love this stuff, I guess. I didn't know that. I would think they just think it's weird.
Well, Sandra likes this stuff. Generalizing it, but, you know. Anyway. Not that I'm saying you're not a woman, Sandra, but no, Sandra's inclined that way. I'm going to shut up now. I was going to actually pimp Gino, but now that we are officially engaged and in a bromance, I'm moving away from that. So the guy I've got is actually a good friend of mine off G+. I met him here. His name is Rob Packer. Australian guy. I was going to show his work last time I was here. This one here, he's a landscape photographer from Australia, this is sort of your worst nightmare if any of you are going to start teaching people how to take photography. This is sort of a worst case scenario because Rob was en route. He landed in New Zealand, was coming to see me in about 3 days into his trip to get a day of field tuition, and the day before he arrived to see me, he posted this shot on G+, and I'm like, okay, this is good, Rob. What the hell am I supposed to teach you? He does some wonderful work. He's got some really interesting stuff from around Australia, and some of the coastal stuff he does is really worth looking at. I'm just going to show one more of his images. I really like this one. It's got a great feel about it. So somewhere in Australia, it's probably not clouds. It's probably about 42,000 hectares of native bush burning, kangaroos and all, I suspect. But I love this sort of shot. It's just dramatic and huge, and it just says a lot about the country he lives in. So go look up Rob Pegger. Very nice guy as well. Super nice guy. That's me.
How do you spell the last name there, Todd?
Packer, as in...
Oh, okay,
Packer. Yeah.
Great. Okay, thanks, Todd. And thanks, everybody. Thanks, everyone, for watching. Thank you, all these wonderful guests that have taken time to come share their tales of ribaldry with us. It's been great. And I'll repost this probably later in the week, along with references to everybody, so you can find new people to circle, new people to follow, and this sort of thing. And we'll be back next week at the same time. We have a couple upcoming shows that you will be excited about. One, we're having the head of product from Adobe Lightroom on, and I'll be lighting him up with a bunch of questions. If you guys have questions ahead of time, let me know. And then we're also going to do an all-Euro fest. We're going to do that probably at a different time because all those Euros are asleep right now, or there's some Euro club doing whatever. But that'll be a special show, and I'll try to do that one before Burning Man, so it should be in the next few weeks. Okay, so that's it from the headquarters here. Thanks again, everybody, for coming. Thanks, Dave and Keith, for helping to produce this thing. And thanks again to all the guests. We can just kind of wave goodbye now.
Bye.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah.
So glad we had this time together. Just to have a laugh or sing a song. Seems we just get started and before you know it.
Stop singing.
Carol Burnett's going to sue us.